All right, welcome back. We're going to switch gears now, of course, looking at the week that was a very interesting week. It has been, always is in Nigeria, and I have here with me two very interesting guests who will be tackling all of the social and political issues that Nigeria has offered this week. Nifemi Oguntoye, thanks for being here today.
Good to be here again.
And of course, Deji Adeyanju, thanks for coming.
Thank you, Buka.
Okay, let's start with Edo State now, and the elections and the drama that, that played out. First of all, the debates held.
That's right.
Very interesting debates, thanks, of course, to Channels Television, which broadcasted, of course, to all of Nigeria. It was an amazing debate, and it was supposed to be build up immediately to the elections. And then the next day or 2 days after, we started hearing talks about a postponement, and then INEC rescinded their decision, and it came back with it again, and eventually it's going to be holding at the end of September. What are your thoughts on that? I mean, especially, like people have said, the APC cried out again against the same thing when the presidential elections were moved in 2015.
Well, really, the postponement really, I don't know how to put it, but it's a mockery of the security agencies, the might and the infrastructure of the security agencies in Nigeria. I understand that about 25,000 additional security agents were sent for that purpose, and now we're talking about an election being postponed for violence or security reasons. It's interesting really to find out at this time that for a country, that for an administration that seemed to have fought insurgency to a stop, mm-hmm. That's what they're claiming. What would have expected that such an important election will be postponed given just a few hours to the D-Day? If elections, for crying out loud, could hold in Afghanistan, why would election not hold in a those states? But there are a lot of fallout of these. How much money will those parties have to spend extra? I mean, you want to think about the implication of that on the party, the implication of that also on voter apathy, because statistics have it that when elections are postponed, people just sit back at home, especially when you are given security as an issue. There is economic recession, and people seem to now have bigger reasons not to go out for the election.
Deji, I mean, the security has been given as a reason. I did see a headline today, I think it was in This Day, where they said the security agencies have been stretched thin. There are about at least 10 major operations going on in this country right now where the security operatives working on in every single geopolitical zone in this country. There's something going on. So with the police, with the military, is that not a valid enough reason for the security agencies to have given, with the fact that, of course, they also said that Edo is not safe? I don't know what that means generally, but is security not a valid reason?
Ebuka, you see, during the campaigns, you know, and Edo decides, not one person was attacked from both sides, either APC, PDP. Nobody was attacked during the campaign. There was no security scare during the campaign. Just a week to election, when obviously the APC had seen all the handwriting on the wall, and after the president's visit, because the president's visit was an error, because the president's visit even, you know, made, you know, the apathy towards APC to become more evident, because people are so angry. You know, this, especially this change begins with me, and so many things have really, you know, angered Nigerians, and the economic situation in the country where people now steal pot of soup while it's still on the fire. You know, so there are a lot of issues that have contributed to why they had to postpone the election. They were so sure that if the election had held on Saturday, they would have lost by a wide margin. What they're trying to do with the postponement is maybe reduce, you know, the margin of their defeat. But I was in Edo. I'm just coming from Edo. You know, I came in from Edo today. What I have seen, you know, in Edo is very simple. The people are tired. The people just want to change the government. They don't even care who they are tired of that 8 years thing and nothing. And like you said about the Channels debate, you know, what struck me most about the debate, the Channels debate, was when the APC candidate, Obaseki, said they were going to provide 200,000 jobs. But and I was asking that these 200,000 jobs, he was the chairman of the economic team of Adams Oshomole. Why didn't they provide these jobs when they were in the last 8 years?
That's besides the point now. The fact remains that the elections have now been postponed. So let's focus on that now. Is it possible that whatever the scare was for this weekend, when elections were supposed to have held, they also mentioned that the Salah holidays came in, it would have also been a problem to get people to vote and all of that. Whatever the issues were, do you think that would be resolved in 2 weeks?
Well, first, I don't agree with him that that election was postponed for political reasons. The last time election was postponed in Nigeria, the opposition party won. So I don't think that APC would have forgotten that too early. But then, the election has now been postponed to the 28th of this month. We're hopeful that they will be able to Putin. Perhaps they were also looking at the holiday on Monday and Tuesday, which was responsible for all of this postponement. But given all that we've seen in the past week, we're hopeful that everything would have been done on the part of government before this rescheduled date.
Interesting. Well, I don't know. It's all for the best. We all want to see elections become more conclusive, especially since all of the elections pretty much have held since the 2015 general elections have been inconclusive, from legislative to state governments and all of that. So hopefully this might be the turn of to new things. But let's go to Chibok now, which has been in the news again this week, DG. We did hear the acting inspector, is he still acting now? Inspector General of Police.
He has been confirmed now.
Saying that the Bring Back Our Girls movements were becoming sort of a nuisance and were creating sort of a problem with their continued protest against government to bring back the girls who were abducted. People found it a little weird because the APC also sort of campaigned on this front, you know, saying that they were going to bring back these girls. Why would they now see it as an issue?
You see, Ebuka, basically, what we are seeing playing out about the Chibok issue is most unfortunate. You know, we were in government, or my party was in government, we have our regrets. We think that we did all our best. We believe that the Chibok Bring Back Our Girls people now see that we did all our best. It wasn't as if we were irresponsible, like the way the opposition then tried to paint us. Just like what the opposition tried to paint us then was that they tried to paint us in several ways to make even those who sell arms to us to stop selling arms for us. Now, Nigerians can see that it should always be about the interests of the nation, not about the quest to get to power. You know, they wanted to get to power by all means. Now they've gotten to power. Deliver on simple campaign promises, just like the issue of Chibok. In fact, I think that PDP should be at the forefront of demanding for this government to bring back the girls, because it was one of the grounds upon which they asked the Nigerian people to vote us out, because they said we could not bring back the girls and that we did not have.
Isn't it also valid? Because we've also heard that, I mean, with any kidnapping in the world, anywhere in the world, the first 48 hours, whatever,
no,
always keep.
Ebuka,
isn't it valid that because things were left too late?
No, Ebuka, let me tell you something, Ebuka. The issue of bring back our girls and the Chibok issue was a peculiar issue. It was done in such a way that when, for instance, if terrorists come to kidnap someone here, you do not obviously, because no one expects that they will come into this studio to carry anyone. So they have element of surprise. That's number one. Number two, they have a game plan. You know, we obviously knew that the government was acting. What the government then did not do was the government did not communicate enough. And we started seeing that change when Mike Omiri started with the information center. Because you could see a government that was willing to do more. But you see, this government has not done nothing. Anything. This government, in fact, look at what they are doing to the Chibok people. They hired pro-Buhari supporters to go and be attacking the Bring Back Our Girls people. The most shameful was they, 2 days ago, they went, you know, gathered some Chibok parents in the, I think either the office or the house of the Minister of Women Affairs, and got the Chibok parents to denounce the Bring Back Our Girls group. This is petty. We don't expect this to come from a government that promised change. For the fact, the excuse that people are using, that because PDP did it, so if Buhari do it now, it's legal. It's wrong. We in the PDP, we did not promise change. You promised change that you will do things differently. So the yardstick of measuring this government is just too, should be extraordinary. You know, this government has failed in almost everything they promised. And this government now coming to say, okay, do this government want the Chibok people to change before this government delivered the promise?
You want to say something?
Yes, really. It's unfortunate that the Buhari administration doesn't appear to have learnt a lot from the previous administration as it regards relating to the Bring Back Our Girls. But we must also get it clear that the position of the police was not banning the protest. They said, we need you to notify us before you go for this protest. And there are also certain routes that you must take for security reasons. And I think that makes a little sense to me. But the bottom line also is that Nigerians need to begin to look beyond the Chibok girls. Earlier this year, I'm not saying that by saying we should forget the girls, but I'm saying that the Chibok girls is symbolic. It's not just about the over 200 girls that were kidnapped from Chibok. We're talking about thousands of other girls that are currently unaccounted for. Just earlier this year, the Nigerian Army altogether said they had rescued about over 300 girls from Boko Haram insurgents. And we must begin to also open our eyes to the fact that beyond the Chibok girls, there are actually many other innocent Nigerian girls who are presently not accounted for. And I also want to begin to see some creativity in the way this protest have been taken. Let's move beyond Abuja. There are other northern states that we can go to, and there are other stakeholders. There are other approaches that we can begin to employ at this time.
Deji, very quickly now before we go on a break, people have said maybe Nigerians are even at fault. We have become extremely we don't push for things anymore. We don't have the willpower to even protest anymore. But even more so the opposition party, which are a member of the PDP, people have said as much as the APC might, quote-unquote, be failing by many people's standards, the PDP isn't doing any better with being an opposition party. And in situations like this, we don't even seem to hear a coordinated response from your party. What is the problem?
Well, Ibuka, for me, I think Nigerians, under Jonathan, they had excess freedom. When I mean excess, Jonathan was a democratic president. He's a president that you can insult him and go to bed as you can go to bed comfortable. Whether you're a journalist, whether
you're saying the PDP is afraid of criticizing.
No, hold on, because you asked a question about Nigerians have become laid back. Mm. And let me tell you why Nigerians are a little bit laid back now. You see, under PDP, there was this certain level of freedom of expression and even freedom after expression. But with this current government, we have seen a situation where everyone in the PDP who has spoken against this government has either been locked up in EFCC or the DSS. They will look for a way to get you down. We have seen ordinary Nigerians who criticize this government.
Hold on.
We have seen ordinary Nigerians who criticize this government, who made Facebook posts. You, Ebuka, you're on social media. You see what is happening. The DSS, EFCC arrest people. They call it cyber stalking. This government specializes in intimidating people who criticize the government. This government specializes in crushing. They've been trying to crush the PDP for like over a year now. Imagine if they focus as much energy as they are trying to use to crush the PDP into just the economy.
So you're saying PDP is not functional because of the APC?
Well, I didn't say that. I'm just telling you because it's a direct reply to the question you've asked. That basically, I agree we need to do more as an opposition. I agree that we as Nigerians, we need to do more. But I think this government should realize
that. Are you also considering whether PDP isn't as credible?
No, the government should consider
isn't a credible itself, opposition.
No, the government should consider that we're in a democracy. Mm. This whole idea of anyone that tries to criticize the government, you crush them. You see, the government tried to, the Emir of Kano, raised some economic issues. And Charles Soludo also raised some economic issue. This government flew a kite. It flew a kite that it was going to prosecute them. 2 days later, it denied that it was intending to prosecute them. We've been in government. We know how these things run. There's a way government can threaten you indirectly, that even you become careful what you say. So we are seeing a government that does not like to be criticized.
If your hands really are clean, there is nothing to be scared about.
That was exactly what I was asking.
Ebuka, PDP, the people that, according to what they are saying, if your hands are clean. For instance, Femi Faneca already got campaign funds to run publicity on channels, on AIT, on newspapers, everywhere. Lai Mohammed got same. Femi Faneca already was arrested and put in EFCC custody, underground cell for 71 days. Lai Mohammed is working free. Can you imagine that? And we're talking about equity in this country. We're talking about that we're in a democracy. Look at Olisametu. Why will an Olisametu be arrested and prosecuted, and he's being prosecuted, and someone like Lai Mohammed and Chief Oyegun, they are working free? We are talking about equity here. If you must investigate PDP campaign funds, you must do the same to APC. The APC chairman has said that APC campaign funds will not be investigated.
Okay, we're going to take a break. We're going to take a break and come back talking more about Nigeria. I mean, when we talk about Nigeria, it's always so heated, especially with politics. But we'll come back and continue more with the week that was. Please stay with us. Let's dance now, it is my turn.
just want